This is the GNU C Library rock. Welcome. I'm not going to stand up here and talk for the 2 hours of this
development for it.
So there is definitely an expectation of user participation in this. I want to see discussion around some of these topics. In fact, some of the topics we have on the slides are topics where there is no community consensus. So we're looking for input from people as to not only what to do, but you know, how do you do it, what do you think is best practice for it. So if you have anything that you want to add to this list, shout it out. We will get to it at the end of the slides, and we'll discuss it. So unlike the other bots, you know, we don't just pontificate about what's coming up and you get to see what's going to happen, because those are things that are just kind of standard. Bug fixing is standard. The things that we don't have consensus on are what we're going to discuss. We need more people to do work, and or people who have experience in having done this already can comment. So one of the issues we kind of face is patch workflow management. And from a high level, what we'd like to see is, you know, GNAME being able to take a patch from a patch worker, following a patch workflow, or if you're taking a patch from your inbox and trying to apply it and test someone's patches, you want that to work as smoothly as possible. The two things that get in the way are having merged drivers for changelogs and having merged drivers for the news file. And those two things we maintain religiously as part of the release process. So if you fix a user visible bug, it has to have a bug in Bugzilla for it, so the users can comment, think it can be written, in this case it can be attached. You then, when you commit, you have to update news, you put the bug in there, but you know, you have to have it 72 lines formatted, and you can Vim, you gotta use GQAP plus you know setAI TW72 and format that change that list of bugs so that it works. The problem is that always conflicts. Like there you need a special merge driver for it, and it's annoying to do that setup every time on your boxes. So the question that keeps coming up is how do we generate both the change log, and this is not a discussion about automatic change log generation. This is how do you generate a change log from a commit. And how do you generate news? Again, this thing isn't going to write, you don't want it, it doesn't write the news for you. But, you know, to give the straw man argument, if you had a commit, and your commit was broken into some kind of structured layout that contained the news entry, the change log, and the, you know, the commit message, could a post hook take this, tear it apart into three pieces, and just slot something into a change log at a later date, slot news in at a later date, right? So you would commit this as a commit message, and then, for example, again, to give a straw man design, just before we do a release, or if you are an individual user, you want to see an updated change log file, you might run, you know, update change log sh, and it has a little bit of metadata, a little text file that's got, you know, dot last commit I looked at, and that changelog sh would walk the commits, assemble the changelog for you so you could look at it. And that would also be something that the release manager would do at the end of the release. He'd run the update, you'd get the updated changelog, you would commit that changelog as part of the release process so that when someone who is downloading that tarball doesn't have the source data associated with it, so doesn't have the, you know, the distributed version control data that came with that release, they at least have that change log and records everything that's gone done. So the change log still has to be written by you. The question is, can it be generated from the commit stuff? So the message is what we have today. Today this has to go into the change log, and today this goes directly to the news file. And these two generate the largest amount of annoying merge commits and or custom merge drivers that we see. Well, so this is an abstract representation of whatever's going into this, but this is really two items. So this is a bug number, right, which is, it needs to add a number to the list, and then it's a news item.
Yeah, okay, so I have, so as far as change logs, historically I've been doing a change log for doing things the old GNU way, and, you know, truth be told, really most of what that was about was just slowing down how quickly we're changing at once. So I think that as far as the change log itself, and the details of how the entry gets there from the commit log, I don't care that much. I think for the meaningful news items, those I think we should continue to treat just the same way a change to the manual would be treated. It's not a magic thing in the commit. You should just include it in your commit, and you know, if you're forgot and or opinions change about what's newsworthy, you know, I think that part should just be part of the overall process.
So you're saying this, you know, we ignore that, we don't.
Yeah, don't put any process for that other than, you know, try to make sure that people think about whether a change warrants a news item.
Yeah, you're right. And so merge failures due to a news item are few and far between. We write like six or seven of them per release.
Right.
But these bugs, it's like every time you commit the bug ID.
Yeah, so here's my proposal, is that for the actual news items, which before a couple so the actual news items, I think, we should just handle normally with normal patches like everything else. It's nice if they come along with the change itself, but it doesn't really matter if it's later or whatever. Or if it gets later edits to make it prettier or whatever. I think that's fine as part of the normal, just like any other part of the documentation or whatever.
Yeah.
For the bug list, I think that should be completely part of the final automated phone bug list. Part of the final release process for like when you
you're saying this should
generating the list of fixed bugs. I think the list of fixed bugs should never exist in the trunk version of the release file. I think
why not?
Because it's just pain.
What's a pain?
Or rather maybe the ones of the release ones.
Well what I mean is what at the time that you got the release for like there should the process of cutting the release branch consists of, you know, you run a script which, you know, trolls Godzilla, you need to figure out Godzilla, you know, flag image and everything to drive this, to generate that list, and then, at, you know, in the same commit in which you change version.
So you're saying that it's, you know, the release drives the, you know, Godzilla.
Right, so like the release manager responsible for declaring a time to cut the branch.
Yeah.
They will do at the same time you do the change version.h from development to release, you also run this generator to sort of seal off the version and the page of the news file.
Yeah, you're gonna do the same thing with the change log as
well. Well, the change log, I think, to avoid hassle, we should probably go to having the change log never exist on the trunk and only actually be committed on the release server. But let's do one more time. So I think for the news file, we should have the sort of the top item with the list of fixed bugs that should be both automated and done only at release time. So it's, you know, it's never going to be corrected on the trunk version later, and you know, make this part of the release checklist of things that you do in the commit, which is the one that gets tagged and phrased as the release.
Yeah.
For the change log, I mean, I
just stop there. There are two other people.
Oh, sorry,
Andres. It was commutable that runs a script that automatically adds in packet 3 parents in the message as a number.
Yeah, so your comment is you have a post commit hook that does some of the automation here. So, and there's another comment.
So, I just draw, I'm not a GNU C committer. I'm just drawing attention from other projects, notably GCC. The problem you have to make sure your process avoids is that you've got a way of reviewing what goes into that commit message if it's subject to any sort of change. So change logs in particular are one of the great inventions of the GNU program, because if you look at old code, they're a savior. And what goes in the commit message, when it goes in, that's it. If there's anything wrong with the change, or if you can't change it, because you're not going to get an amendment push if it's a community project. So I would say you need to have a process that, if you're going to do that, at least allows you to review those entries before you commit. The second thing is to draw attention, if you look in the GCC contrib directory, you'll find a script, I think it's called mucklog, which actually generates a template changelog entry from a git diff. And that's a very useful tool, so use it the whole time.
Okay. So the comments that have been bandied about are, if you've got your changelog on the commit, you could actually attach a git note to that commit to correct the changelog.
And so I can point which Joseph phrased, I think it's correct. Git notes should be off the table because they're not part of the shared permanent history, they're assigned.
Okay. So you don't want them at all?
Yeah, if you do git clone, you don't get git notes.
Oh.
So
yes. I thought they were attached to all the objects and you actually get them if you push them.
Okay, I'm not the most expert on git, but but it should be something that is, we don't, if we do want any kind of thing, personally I think, you know, in essence we're sort of deprecating change log as being a first class thing. Going to be looked at by people who aren't using Git repository.
Yeah, but people are going to want to generate that change log.
I agree.
Up to date. They're going to want to keep it up to date in their own brand.
I'm fine. But I don't think we need to worry all that much about, oh, the bit that I formatted my bit message that drives the change log generation, I had a typo or I forgot one file. You know, something like that.
We do need to make sure that generator is robust enough so that
it doesn't crap out.
So, but one thing that we can do is, so in the event of a change log being incorrect,
I think it's going to, no, it's going to happen frequently, and there are going to be people that are going to be upset about not being able to correct those. Like, I think attribution in a change log is going to be one which you're going to have people being upset saying, that patch was, you know, I worked on that, you put the wrong name on it, you got it wrong, you fixed it. No, sorry.
Why do you need an attribution?
Don't judge. Attribution. That person wants that and they get the work.
Don't judge.
Yeah.
So attribution can have a different mechanism to attribution. You say signed off by who, and you can have arbitrary number signed off by.
Yeah.
This is what a lot of products do.
So I'll make a note here about kernel process here, because that I think that should be a separate topic, but go on.
So you can set sign off by separate, that's
what
you want to get. Make a mistake in the change log format, you can have so the process could be such that you generate the change log at that point and edit it and do a separate comment just for the change log. Because that will never
gets us.
space for people that actually use it and compare it against the time that we spend on building. Because if there's, you know, if it's really not efficient for us to do so, then we should have a simple mechanism. As for example, if there's a problem with attribution, we could have a separate file. We write it in the news file, right? In the news file, we have a section saying issues in a change log, or something like that. We say, commit hash foo was done by person X. You know, if the attribution is really problem, you can just put a note on the web page or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, for attribution, I think if there's concern about
it. So attribution is the only mistake in the change log that I can think of. I justify saying, yeah, you know, I need to find some way to address what this person feels is harm.
Right.
As a steward, it's the only thing that.
So I think there's lots of ways to give people credit.
Yeah.
In release announcements, we always list all the names in news items.
But those names are generated from the GIT.
No, I understand. But the point is, you know, people's names get into the news file. You can have an author's careers file. There's lots of ways to give people credit, and we don't need to complicate our process and working and everything.
Yeah.
Well, for the discussion, you don't mind people who are talking because you're fighting the power of the other side.
Oh, alright.
So you need quite hard to hear when they're talking towards the front.
We'll haul this around now.
So, how tracking start the war as well? Carlos is doing that.
Anyways, you get that as a dot one, and two people committing the same file, the same name. So.
Yeah.
There is a scenario, but it's a bit complicated to describe here.
You can go with that.
So, I mean, we've said no to Git notes, we've said no to newsletters. We've said kernel process signed off by, if we can agree to that, for getting things into the commit message to give attribution as a way to give attribution.
So we can actually
Right. We can accept the, so I wrote kernel process and signed off by, but I really mean we can accept the, like, as much of the kernel process as seems reasonable for us, because people already know how that's supposed to work. And so the model, the mental model that people have functions.
Just a few remarks. Git notes basically related on the regular files, so the approach to correct change log entries. This approach is visible.
You can't use
Git notes as is, but you can implement something like a regular file with corrections to commit messages.
So, yeah, and that regular file would have very few
merge
issues, right? Because the corrections would be few in between.
Yeah,
it would be automatically measured with a merge driver.
Except for we want to do that.
Yes, these are possibilities, but as I've said, I think 5 times now, I think there's some typos, which is not that important that you should worry about.
Typos don't matter. It's usually a stack here.
Yeah, well, and as I said before, I think the change log need not be the primary means of giving credit, so that we don't need to.
Yes.
But so then I think the question becomes is, is there an agreed upon way to give credit? And are we going to present that as a kernel process for writing down everybody's, act by, tested by, all the kinds of things?
I have a question about news entries. If these numbers has some meaning between the users, if, I'm not sure, but if some of the things at least, the most difficult part of this merge process is absence of matching driver that could do this complicated stuff. I actually use a merge driver for myself.
Well, the problem is merge drivers complicate new committers and people who are just figuring stuff out and playing with it. If I could tell you about a 1 hour
company. So you do have 2 hours, but you have about 25 minutes on this, which I think is a pretty trivial topic that you actually don't have any deep disagreement on.
No newsletters, is there any consensus between either one of these processes? You think it should be the release brought to Bugzilla, the news entry generation? Does everyone agree with that?
Everyone
against that? And the commits driving news of Bugzilla to the other round? Well, today commits do drive a Bugzilla update, but that's the only thing for knowing.
No, you commits annotate Bugzilla, but that's not reliable.
Okay.
We need to figure out, not now, but figuring out our, Bugzilla flag or whatever it is, magic details, that is what we'll use to make the generation of the, list of fixed bugs come out. So that needs to be figured out. And beyond that, I don't think any of this.
We can, we find the flags that set it and say, what releases are fixed in and things like that.
Right.
So then what we'll do is we'll propose this process. When we're done, we'll propose the standard message with signed off bys as a method of giving attribution for everyone so that we don't have to deal with the issue of people asking us, well, how do you correct the change log that you didn't
The point, the concern raised about attribution was missed attribution.
Yeah.
Needs to be added later. And that's with any automated process, there's always that possible. Right? You can forget to add a signed off by.
I know, but it is less likely if you begin your docs process.
But like I said before, I think you should just not worry. Missed attributions, we should just address by making sure that we are giving people pulling credit in other ways.
Yeah.
In the release notes or whatever it is, to make sure that we should never worry about it.
So
and,
if we
and no longer one.
So if we get rid of the locale data change log and just switch to one top level change log and then be done with it. Because the generator gets complicated if you have more than one.
Agreed. So the reason that we had separate subdirector change logs in the past was because of there being some idea of separate maintenance responsibility way back when. So we have those two locale logs, and way back when we had the idea that maintaining the locale data would sort of be done by a different set of people than for it to be seen, and it has not.
Yeah, the more locks would maintain the locale data.
It has not worked out that way, and so I don't think having that be separate is buying us anything.
No.
And I think after that, now the only other separate chain one that still has the IDN, which hasn't changed in all the years, so who cares for
it? I think my perspective, the first thing we do is get the community to sign off on one change log. Once you have one change log, then the script to generate these from the commits becomes much easier to just dump into one file. You're doing it on the every release, and then we've got the news file being generated by some RPC talk to Bugzilla, I assume, right? Get a query of the bugs that are fixed in release. And these new settings are still written by hand in the news file. We'll have to merge with them, so like six of them every release, it doesn't matter. And a potential for some way to give people more attribution. So does that complete this? Then we're done.
I think so, and I think at 28 minutes of the pure bytecode issue, we should call it closed for today.
Done.
Can someone take a picture of the slides or someone
listening?
Yeah, you'll remember this?
You're being recorded.
Oh, we're being recorded. Excellent. I don't know if the recording captures the entire view of the.
It's got the whole blackboard and the
projector. Yeah. All right. Thanks, Andrew. So the next thing that I wanted to talk about was install tree testing. And so Joseph Myers has convinced us a lot about what the testing should look like, what a testing revamp for Joseph should look like. My most basic thought is that whatever we do should be incremental. I think converting all of the tests to one thing or the other is a pile of work that we don't want to do. And Arjun's here, and so I want to say thanks, Arjun, for all the test skeleton changes you've been committing are great, right? Moving everything eventually over to test skeleton is a good thing to do. You have time and things like that. So the point of the install tree testing is that you install glibc into a directory and you run the tests in an environment that looks as much like the install system as possible. And
so the key thing that you're not having made is that is relevant thing is test being compiled from source against, there's both running test binaries against the install instance, but also there's the issue of compiling tests from source against, the installed header library environment instead of the, internal header stuff that is how they get built today.
Yeah.
And I think we have, a tiny handful of tests that actually
there's a growing number of tests that want to use atomic.h and a couple other internal headers that would not be accessible if they had gotten, they compiled against the install.
Right, so I think as the general point about doing everything incrementally, I think we can sort of figure out what works for the majority of tests, which are just sort of, end user, full, normal, kind of state, and figure out what works for those and start migrating the ones that do fit into that. And then we could look again later at the ones that actually need internal headers.
Yeah, so your suggestion is then tests that are newly written should attempt to be written against the install tree headers, the install tree libraries, and should be compiled from the install tree rather than the way they've done now, which is compiled against the build tree, basically.
Right, and I think where we basically are going to wind up getting to
might not work due to patching symbols.
Say again?
There is a problem that it might not work if there are patching symbols that you are trying to test.
So you're saying that if you're trying to test a version symbol,
yes, and you would add something to you.
We can talk about that. There is a process where you can actually trick the static linker with an alias in the assembly to actually reference the old version symbol. It's not well documented, but we could talk to the GNU guys and say, how do you get a secret way to reference the old symbol without having to have a hacked up, stubbed DSO to link again? Is that what you're talking about?
But you would, if you have part of the C library, then you wouldn't get to the simple part of all of that. So you could be like that.
I don't understand the.
Where you have a new version simple, but you don't test it because you would call it a part of the simple.
But if you're compiling against the newly built libc, you're going to get the new symbol. That's the preference. You're going to be using that. The problem is you don't test the old symbol anymore. You don't test the compound. Okay.
So,
Florian had a question, so I'll bring that back down to him though.
It's sort of related to the symbol testing. When we have a hidden function, we can't use the installation tree because we don't have the internal header file, and we have to have some process for internal unit testing to get to hidden functions that maybe just file examples, because there's not only the installation tree, at least as far as the header file is concerned.
Yeah. So you're right in that. For unit tests or more tightly coupled tests that aren't public API tests, it may mean that we have to accept that some tests are going to be installed tree built, and those are the ones that can test internals, and then the unit tests that are, you know, external tests that aren't going to be, they can be built in the install tree, and those are the ones that we can test against any public organization, right? Does that make sense? It might just be that the comment is we actually end up with just two sets of tests. One is the external test for external public APIs, and the other one is the one for internal things. Would that solve the problem?
And then the internal is
sort
of staying
in. Yeah, the internal will stay in the tree, and the other one are going to go in this new subdirectory, which is, you know, install tests or.
So there's a project called libc tests. I think Florian pointed out, it's part of the muscle project. It's not part of the muscle project. It's driven by the people who are working on the muscle project. Maybe we could, for the external tests, we could somehow join hands with them and maybe come up with a separate package, libc tests, and
sure.
Enhance that.
That's certainly possible. I mean, unfortunately, there may be,
There are many issues regarding. So I guess the other question is, if we need to run tests that require pivot root or that require some kind of C group to be tested effectively, so we need to bring up a network and we want to run a test named D, like a hacked up named D that returns specific responses, test failure pass in the stub resolver, what dependencies do we feel comfortable including? Because I mean, you know, if there were hipsters in the crowd, they'd say, well, you Docker, right? You put a Docker image and you run the test inside Docker. So how much are we willing to accept to get what we want, which is good stub resolver testing in a separate network namespace, good UID, GID testing for those functions in a separate user namespace or inside the effectively C group.
So
the things, how much like is LibLXC an acceptable dependency?
I understand the starting point of today, basically those are things for which we have no test now. We have XCheck, which is
you know, a handful of tests that have random, you know, arbitrary dependencies you have to manually figure out. So to a first approximation, we have zero tests of this category, and so, and I think perhaps this is a good category to be, you know, substantially separate, you know, perhaps me not living, even living in the glibc tree at all. And I think basically, you know, whatever works. And I don't think we should be too concerned about it because we're not giving up anything now. Right now, we just don't have any testing. So I think whoever wants to do the legwork of setting up a framework for writing that kind of tests and getting it going, they do whatever they do and we'll see how it goes. And I don't think we need to worry about it. You know, of course,
but you
can't be non-free dependencies. But besides that, I don't think that I'm not concerned about, well, I'm more concerned about us getting some testing that, that is, you know, source code for which is a shared resource and something that actually reliably works in an automated way so that somebody can set up automated testing. Somebody show up and start doing something, and once we have some useful tests, we can worry about if we want to constrain the dependencies. I don't think we need to worry about that right now because, you know, it's not like we're in danger of hamstringing ourselves because right now we just have zilch.
Yeah. Okay. But there may be, yeah, people may want to put those into the, you know, into the GNU C repo, so the main check works as expected.
VMs or whatever the hell you need.
Yeah.
So not everybody's
going to
do it
forever. So, I will bring it up. We have tests. I would like to have those tests out somewhere for someone who's a lot of those are like NSC, which is basically not tested at all, right?
Yeah. And so, you should give it to yourself and get background about, you know, what you work on, because people don't know.
Yeah, so I did pre-query for GNU C Library. And it's basically customers report problems, and Carlos is an issue if you fix something, and I have to prove if it's fixed or not. And if it's tests that require changing, you know, it's usually tests that require changing system configuration, something in EC or right, resolve or NEC.
Yeah, you guys test for all of that.
Right, we have tests for all that. I don't think I would be able to probably just publish all of them like on day one. But if there was a framework to put them in, then I would like to. And I don't know very much about how this works, but I don't mind using timeline if someone can help me out.
Well, I think you know what you do in Red Hat QE is the most knowledge any of us has about what sort of framework requires. So I say, you know, go to town and ask questions about how to do things, but as far as direction about how to use it, how to do it, and what kind of framework to use, you've already got stuff internally that works.
So right from the top level, the point is, if the community rejects the idea of this, we're not going to do it. And then the next thing is what architecture of type of test the community uses. From my perspective, you're saying you don't care if the, you know, the idea is good. We all want whole system tests. We all want LD config to get tested. It doesn't today. We all want the stub resolver to get tested. It doesn't today. We all want more network testing. The networks are important. It really doesn't get tested today, except by specific QE departments at particular companies which are driving test automation through these interfaces. And the idea is same. And so the question is, is you say you don't care about the architecture that really gets implemented? Because we have zero tests today, so it doesn't anything is better than
nothing. I'm sure there will be lots of debate about details, but I don't think we need to set out any principles about what dependencies are okay or whatever. You know, just get something that works, is public, is, you know, two people who
test is the right direction to take it, Richard?
So, public label request.
Yeah, and that's why you're here, and that's why we have BOF.
We have really said privilege settings for doing all the testing. So, please don't put in place a framework which requires everyone to have elevated privilege levels.
So, you're saying that as much as possible, the testing should
require non-root. Most of the development should not require root, and most of the testing should not require root.
Right, so
it's all
right.
The ultimate testing.
So, we're talking about.
We're not allowed to have demon processes that get elevated privileges in our system here. It has to be a real person who does that level.
Well, so, Richard, we're talking about additional testing that by its nature requires.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. That's fine. But yeah. Please don't end up in a situation where the only way you can test it.
Absolutely. I don't think anybody's proposing that. Yeah. Certainly would object to any of our sort of normal tests that don't have
to be moved. As long as we understand each other, that's
fine. Yeah, everything that can just be in main check.
Yeah.
Stay in main check.
Yeah, anything that, you know, so it might be the case that, you know, Roland suggests this is a separate project in which recognize that these are standard glibc tests you should be running. In fact, the maintainer brings in pay to run the full gamut of system tests for which I think you will require root because you need to make a separate namespace, you have to test the stuff resolver, and those things are, you innately need stuff that acts. But as a developer, if you've got a box you're sitting on, it's the hardware assigned to you, you've got root, you know, you will be able to do that here and there.
Yeah, a lot of companies do
not,
but do not, I know it's
not that's great, you know, so the response is that, you know, the response to that might be, you know, we talk to the power farm guys and say, can we have time on machines in some way, some environment to run, to let people run tests on the current. So that problem is solvable in different ways. So
I'll try to predict what you're saying, those are the testing.
Yeah. Absolutely. So the standard API testing that we have today will remain there. The standard internal unit testing we have today will grow and remain there. Neither of those will require root. But the coverage we have today is incredibly poor for the things that require root access for the testing to configure.
For the discovery model, we could avoid the exploratory testing by adding needs to set the pod number and address of the next server. So if one process the next server and redirect the C to that basic.
Yes.
And that would that suggests to me that there has to be some integration between the C and the test. Or we have to put these kinds of tests into the C because it's going to touch accounts and we're probably not committed to supporting this as an external API.
Yeah. That could be one of the ways we could resolve it. So, to be honest, it always makes me worry when you have an internal switch to flip the alternate port and things like that, because those things are security issues. And, you know,
yeah.
Having fixed constants in there, you don't change it, you test, and then you ship it, you test it, always works better. But I agree, you know. So, the in between is you have those tests that you build that behave very differently, right? The way they are today in build tree. Then you have tests in which they're pretty close to the installed system. You tweak some constant parameters between the ports and you test them. You're fairly certain they're going to work when you deploy them. And then you have the final integration testing that is, you ran it in a container with a different network namespace and you use the exact port you know you're going to be shipping with, right? So that's just a spectrum of fidelity of testing. Does that make sense? And you're just arguing that maybe the middle ground is good enough.
Yeah, especially if people don't want to have root privileges for testing. But
yeah.
I think we have to touch the code.
It may be that the people that don't have root privileges for testing may need to step up and assist in figuring out how to do the stuff.
I think we could do stuff like that on a case by case basis.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, we have something, you know, vaguely along those lines in the, you know, in the iPhone testing thing where we have this, you know, physically accessible but, you know, informally private interface for getting at internals. We can add things like that as needed when they make sense for testing. And I think
namespace is something that we can expand with documented internal name, internal functions that do useful things for us in testing. You commented on the fact for yourself that, you know, we have GNU C private and we could expose more entry points there that made sense for us for the testing. There was someone who had a comment over here. Max.
When talking about install tree testing, we need to touch on the question of which system directory layout are to be supported. So obviously, glibc is heavily developed by .NET, and the upstream glibc does not always freely install in the Debian or Ubuntu type directory layout for file systems. So what we are talking about that, we need to not be very a single distribution specific and make sure that install tree testing will work not on the other end of the door, but also on patches to support other distros will be welcome.
I agree 100%.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I will say the I think Ross, Boy, Lanero said, you know, who's going to look at true-based testing? Lanero needed some of this for the cross-target testing. Do you know if Rob made any progress with this? And I think I asked Ryan this already, and it's kind of like, you know, yes, I know some progress was made, but it's not to the level where it's where we want it to be for GNU C people.
So what is the specific question? Whether truth-based testing of
GNU C? Last year, Rob Savoy commented that he was going to, or wanted to work on, truth-based install tree testing for GNU C.
That is not implemented yet. We are doing truth-based testing of GCC wearable. So we do not run GNU C test suites, but for our GCC testing, we install the boot compile GNU C into true and then run GCC tests against that boot compile install GNU C. So we don't run GNU C testing yet inside true because it's
you bootstrap all the way up to the final rebuild of GCC, and then you run the stage one bootstrap, you run the GCC test suite with the newly built GNU-C.
Yes. So, we didn't do that for GNU-C yet because we just doing the function testing.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay. So I think that's that for that topic. I think we accept that it's a separate project. We're going to look at integrating that in some way so you can check it out and talk about that on the list. But it seems like there's no opposition to it. There's general consensus that we want this. There's an understanding that we're going to have external dependencies to handle the C group or container aspect of the standard test. And I think Richard's comments are apropos that, and said as well, the developers don't have root. So we definitely need to look at a solution that, from an architectural perspective, doesn't require root. Do we miss anything else?
I think that is.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Maybe. Yes. I'll let you talk about this. Yeah.
LTO, this is not like a big issue, but Michael happened to ask me over a drink the other day, what about LTO? Is anybody building loops with LTO? And as far as I know, nobody has tried it in recent years, and LTO has gotten better than it was. It would be great if somebody, and this could be done by somebody who doesn't do a lot of those, be happy, just take a crack at trying to build with LTO and see what the build problems are. I think we know that even once you get it built, there's the potential that the LTO build may be subtly buggy because in some of our current, current cleanup analysis, we've noticed some places where we say, well, this turns out technically be safe because the compiler won't do X, Y, and Z because there's a function call here, and that's, relying on that is obviously incompatible with LTO. And so I think it's our expectation that until Torvalds finished and the cleric blesses us as memory model correct, then LTO will probably introduce some bugs. But there's probably also some other, GCC bugs or random locations we're not thinking of or built system issues that will come up. And so if anybody wants to take this on, I think that would be a great thing to do, and we could work out, incidental issues independent of those concurrency concerns, though I think we certainly would not advise anybody to turn on the LTO build for building a real production of C until we're confident about our concurrency.
Question?
Yeah.
So, just wanted to note the same thing I read at the LTO session, that they probably should fix the issue with marking built-in functions, as this is the function that does it, like memcopy, or otherwise you would run into all those issues with the LTO testing. So if you could actually mark it that, don't do anything with this. It doesn't work. You have to issue no built-in copy or so.
requested profiles?
Profile, yeah. That's something that would be nice that is kind of its own can of worms. Somebody wants to take it on, then we can start with it. This is, it has similar issues to things like the sanitizer enabled builds where because we're at the lowest level of runtime, there's complexity in the mountain instrumenting the instrumenters, those I think that can be in the same bucket of these are all, lovely compiler technologies that maybe could benefit us and so much. I know all about this state, so, and I'm sort of long ago crowd and all that stuff.
Another 6 months or
before the next release.
Why? It's only been a year
since.
I think
I'll be releasing
the version quite soon.
Yeah.
But there is still more work to be done.
Yeah, for sure.
But, you know, the
same way of progress is great progress, and where you are now is amazing progress compared to where we were.
Yeah, you're an amazing place.
Yeah,
too.
We'll pay you 6 times more.
Yeah, I said the Futex page used to be like 3 lines, and now it is like, you know, 600 lines of stuff described for us.
Yeah, for Futex kernel implementation,
yeah.
It required, you know, 1,000 patches and fixes and new features.
But it is a seriously important piece of, you know, kernel infrastructure for user space synchronization, and it continues to be relevant for more than just UMC.
It's like the most contracts with kernel and release document.
Yeah.
So there's about 20 fixes in there still.
Okay.
And some wording of what we need fixing on. I imagine Cauldron has got an opinion about some of that.
Yeah.
But the next iteration will also include the CL on
scratch. Yeah. Now, no, I'm watching that. So, I mean, I guess maybe the burn down of those 20 issues might take us another 6 months. Depends.
No,
because people have that time anyway. Okay. All right. So I will, you know, I'll also review and, you know, see if there's anything I can help with. But I think the kernel guys are the number one contributor to say what is the expected interface. So, do you have any comment on that for help?
Not directly, but I just need to say that I'll have a bit more to say about PNC in the one talk that I have tomorrow, and I have a tutorial tomorrow as well. I'll try to teach about some of the background about how to reason about it. Maybe that's helpful here. One point that I think is important here regarding working on the PNC documentation is that I've been revising lots of the coherent code in the glibc, but I think it's really important that the community understands coherency. And the important part there is that for the community to be able to communicate about coherency, and for that we need to have a shared set of terminology and, you know, patterns that we agree on are being used in glibc and understood by many people in glibc, because we don't end up, I want to end up in a case or a state where we depend on one person or something to keep things running.
Yeah.
And so, even if you don't work on coherency, it would be nice if you could just try to be familiar and contribute to setting a standard of communication and thought, mental concepts and things like that, that you say, okay, those are the things we use in the project.
Yeah.
So I will just say, maybe may I follow the, my current approach with that is, Torvald will do the review, and he says it's okay, I'm sure it's good. and I think Paul says it's not reasonable to put that all on you. So, but I am willing, as you're, you know, a very good expert on that and open explaining it, that the tutorial they're doing and the ongoing work of helping educate us all, we're all relying on you for that.
I'll say something. I think, you know, the list of required reading, you know, the wiki page for concurrency, getting people to be able to read through that stuff and learn some of the common nomenclature that is being used to describe and talk about concurrency, it's super important. And I think I did Sudesh's review. I did the review of the TLS LTLS TLS detour patches. And what I did for that was I exposed some of my own internal thought process. Remember, I put the rough notes in there. And then what I was hoping was, Torvald, you could comment. You did. So if you do, I would say if you do PNC reviews of something that has concurrency, put your own rough notes into that nail so that other people see the mental approach that you took to review the concurrency code, and then others can comment on that and make sure that we're using the same language and the same thoughts, because some of the things I did, you commented on in the video, don't think of the threads, don't think of the locks as if they were fences, think of them as just locks and start with that high level thought process of these locks order these pieces of code, don't think of them as fences. Even though in my mental model I was breaking them down into fences and thinking about the ordering in that respect, it was more complicated than I should have done. So I think it's important.
important if you, I would say to anyone who's doing parallel and concurrent code review, post your internal notes or rough notes that you wrote to yourself while you did the review. So I think it's relevant to show the reviewer your work that you did when you did the review so that they can comment on the rough notes in process.
And I might just stress this again, my colleague just said, it's not just that you say how you understood it, but when you say that, it gives feedback for us to actually know how we are going to talk about it, right? Because there are a lot of things, a lot of mental models that are correct or incorrect, but there's no one size fits all. So it must work and it must be convenient for the people working on GLibc. And for that, it's important that people say how they're thinking about that so we can find a common language.
Yeah. Okay. I don't have anything else to add to all of this. I think you're going to cover a broad spectrum of this. This was just the single point here that Roland and I were coming up with more work for you and Michael to do, which is to find out what to make sure that it's on the page that we need to look at what is that contract for some of the additional interfaces where the kernel does a put user, right, to a user space address. And then the question is, well, what are the guarantees? Was that store release? From the user space side, you have the right to inquire against the release, and what do we see because of it? Buildbot slaves, right now, huzzah, IBM. Any IBM people in the audience? You guys are doing a good job. Google's doing a good job. Everyone else is slackers.
I get success, Sam, so.
Yeah, here it comes.
The way that it's set up, I don't think there's any
take on the responsibility of supplying some slaves. Earlier this year, somebody at Lenaro said it would be no problem to supply that person that's left at Lenaro. So I saw it earlier at Lenaro.
Yes. An AR-64 Lenaro build slave would be awesome.
Yeah.
So
get enough build slaves.
Internally, I have a 48-port machines.
Right.
So,
yeah, so that's going to be taken or Ryan to promise those resources. But I think every other machine needs to
should
step up and try to play.
And so would it be possible to add slaves to GCC compiled files? So we can
that seems possible. I think we need to,
last year the point was someone needs to liaise with the GCC compile farm maintainers and say, can we carve out parts of that compile farm?
The GCC compile farm is not just for GCC, it's for any GNU free software.
Project. Okay, yeah, so it's a GNU compile farm.
Yeah, so I think it's a GNU compile farm. It's known as the GCC compile farm because that's where it ran on the biggest. So if you've got right access to any free software project, you should be able to get a login on those boxes.
But
it's not clear to me what I don't know what the
expectation
or policy is about having an automated bot running.
I think some of the GCC buildbot work like Jan Benedict Gloss, I might have pronounced his name wrong, but I think some of that work is actually happening on the GCC compile farm machines. It's something that can be discussed for sure.
Sure.
And on the subject of AR64 machines, I'm working on trying to get some machines into the compile farm. I have no timelines yet. It's work in progress. Watch the space.
So maybe some of the R-oriented folks can say too. When I had a previous conversation about this, my impression was that the ARM64 machines would be able to also run ARM32 utilizing the same. Okay. Yours not so. You can maybe provide ARM64 slaves, but not ARM32, and it would be great to get both ARM64 and ARM32 slaves, whether they are the same machine or not.
So the machines I'm thinking of. I'm working on trying to get into the compile farm support both AR64 and AR32.
Great.
So that's the one that I'm trying to get.
Yeah, I mean, just as with x86, every x86 slave will be one that both runs 64 and 32 builds, and you need more of those. And also, this is probably more of an issue for x86 than anything else, but also having slaves that are different. Distributions currently, the slave I have is Ubuntu 14, so that was easy to set up. And actually, because I assumed it was Ubuntu's fault that the Cobar tests were read, I tried to set up an engine, but there's no buildbot packet out of the box for sendos, so I timed that after 3 minutes on setting that up. But we should get as much coverage of machines, distributions, and GCC versions as we can, and none of this is hard. It just needs people, the machine resources and the legwork, and I think the time for legwork is more of a constraint than the machine resources for everybody. It would be great also to get, some of the machines that, the less priority machines that don't have enterprise distributions and whatever, a few, according to Richard Henderson, QMU is the premier way to test anything for alpha, so anybody who can just provide an x86 slave that can run QMU alpha or QMU VM of whatever other, obscure machines, that is useful too, but requires a lot of work to set that up. So I'd like to get, volunteers signed up to do some more of this stuff.
I think the comment is that, while I like the GCC compile farm,
Oh yeah, let's say that talk. I like the GCC compile farm as a way. I think that Roland, you touch on the paid maintainers. It would be great, if you think about how to contribute one of those slaves and keep one of those slaves running, because the slave represents the kind of perpetual contract, the thing that you're interested in always having building. And it behooves you to say, well, look, it went red, and we're going to revert your patch because that went red, right? So we already have community consensus that if you break stuff, we can yell at you, revert your patch. We don't normally do it because we're kind of really nice now, but we could get more thorough.
So if I so currently we have the situation where when anybody has a change that either has to touch, architecture that they don't test themselves, or he doesn't touch sysdev's files of that architecture, but there's some suspicion that it may require testing across architectures. Currently what happens is we're sort of a little nervous and conservative about that, and so somebody says, well, here's my change, I've tested it on x86 and whatever one other thing, and can this architecture test it? Can this architecture test it? And for some of our less used architectures, we also have maintainers who only check in every couple of weeks to look and do that stuff. And that sort of slows down general velocity. And actually, if we had pretty thorough buildbot coverage and the build working so it's normally green, then we can be much more cavalier about those things. If there's sort of consensus of everybody who did show up that day for review, then you can just go in and then you can see on the buildbot if it broke Spark and then worry about it as opposed to waiting for when Dave Miller has
So does that mean you're saying that the onus is on Dave Miller, for example, to get a Spark build slave? If you don't get the Spark build slate, we're just going to go ahead and start committing these things because Dave reviews only every release.
Right. And I think once we have a beautiful buildbot set up where x86 and ARM and Power and 390 and all the ones that, where there's paid people with big machine resources can do it, once all of those architectures are in a first class state, then it will become reasonable to say, I know Dave has some machines.
He has Niagara
boxes. He's given me a long time, so I guess I can say that. But once we do that, then we can, and we can say, hey, Tylera, Microblade, whatever, everybody set something up, or else just expect to be broken before too long. I don't think we need to be too aggressive about that. Yeah. But the first step will be to get those, sort of first class enterprise architectures to be very well represented in our buildbot.
Yeah.
So let's go through on that.
The GNC buildbot isn't documented on the libc website at all. The first time I knew it existed is right now.
Well, it's not useful.
Yeah.
It's not yet useful.
So there is a URL for it, and I can read it right now.
I have a URL, but
we haven't put it in the wiki and everything because it is not yet.
So
there enough to actually be useful.
But we won't get more people piling onto it apart from those.
I agree. But
it's actually it's
until we get endeavor to get one fully green build.
Yeah.
Then it's a little bit unreasonable to be asked.
They all build, but they don't check right.
Yeah.
So I'll let Sadesh talk and then I'll let Mark make a comment.
So I hope very soon
So Matthew actually asked the question that I was going to ask, which is, do you actually have a concise set of instructions to set up a buildbot? Because this sounds like something that can be done outside of the core community.
Yes.
Is it in the wiki?
There's just some files in that repository.
All right.
And so I'm about to pause.
The
Twilio managed to figure it out.
You posted the instructions. I remember seeing the list. Like, it got posted into the list.
Yeah, they got posted the pointers to the repository you need to check out, and there's some readme files and stuff in that. It's all very primitive and needs some, are some instructions they need to be improved.
Yeah, so the Power 8 system that you see, the middle build, Julio set that up, so he knows how to do it, and it's gone through.
No, so my point is that if there is a concise set of instructions, maybe someone who has a blog and has a few hundred bits a day or something like that can actually blog about it and get people to try this thing out. I'll say what you
call it. Yeah, I'd say currently I would not say it is a concise and correct set of instructions, but I think with another iteration of our core folks setting up a couple of slaves, then we will get those instructions fixed up.
Great. So, but eventually you should probably be doing that so that you get a broader set of coverage.
100%.
Yeah. I do have one question.
Yeah, go on. Yeah. Does the buildbot slaves need to be accessible from the outside or only the internal?
No, they just need to be able to make some kind of webby connection to the master, that's all.
Okay.
Yeah, they report back stats to the master and the master aggregates those results.
It's all you know, sort of slave to master driven, so it could be behind firewalls.
Yeah, it could be that temporary hardware inside that runs the slave, and then that slave has to
have access. Yeah, I mean, but my slave in Google Compute Engine, I'm not even sure if it has an external IP address.
No. Okay. That's one more. Yeah, that's right, Mark. Sorry.
I just want to say, look at the GDB wiki. Sergio has been setting up.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
And he also has a Git repository with the master files and slave files. And
is that monster software?
No, it's not running on SourceWare, but well,
at least
so probably something like this. Want for TWC. It's not all green, it's lots of red. But at least Sergio knows PowerPC, maybe SG90 people. So
did he get the SG90 stuff out of the new build? Where is he running those builds from?
The SG90
is the only green one.
Yeah, SG90 is the Maris University server.
Okay.
Where all the news
would get developed. I think it's a reasonable policy to say IBM should supply SG90.
Okay. But anyway,
we have this. Like, Red Hat also has a capability to probably carve out some machines for that.
If you talk to Julia, he's talked about we're trying to get an SG90 qualified.
Okay. So then we should be reaching out to Sergio then and coordinating with him because between GDB and glibc, we should be having more of this stuff.
Yeah.
And the wiki is actually pretty nice. So.
Okay. All right. No, that's a good point, Mark. So we'll have to take note that we go to the GDB guys and ask them kind of what they ran into and what's going to work for us.
So just to sort of wrap up this.
Yeah.
The subject. So I, sort of got the ball rolling, but then, I haven't really done a whole lot, and I'm not sure how much I can do. I will take on moving the repo to some place that we can all access, and then is there anybody who will volunteer to sort of drive the general improving this and remind us all to do it? All right.
I gotta get it done. I put it on my official work. I'll be demoted if I go between that or the install testing as well.
Alright. Let's move on so we have a half an hour until then.
There you go. So Andrew, this one's for you. So AR64 and HP timing support. The high precision timing on AR64, now Richard, correct us if we're wrong, is an optional server extension, but what was the actual architectural, there was a set of instructions, and I forget what you call them, like the virtual timing?
Yeah, it's the virtual timing. So they're
on the build my own.
Okay.
So the git, the global timer, the GT, is an optional feature in ARM v8, but it's required for the server profile. And so obviously most glibcs are going to be server profile built and everything. And so requiring it is required.
So the point we wanted to make is that this issue's come up twice in the past, 8 months, and there wasn't really any consensus on how to fix this, but Roland and I discussed this. Roland, do you want to talk about it?
So
there is, we have a solution for you, and I think within a day of work, you could get a thing in, and then we could have it done, and it would be available.
Yeah. Okay, so if people who are creative about AX or want to say that just for GNU purposes, AR64 always will lose this feature, if that's a reasonable thing to say, then say it. I don't know. If it's not, which I think is
a conservative position, that the server profile is
right. Yeah.
things like if DL hardware cap block my bit is set, then do it. Otherwise,
right now, right now it's time. HP timing is actually a compile time slush, so it would have to be reconfigured.
Right.
No, it's not. You can just turn it on.
But you just say, you always say it's available. So you just turn it on one and then.
The question is then, does that create doing something?
Yeah, you have to do get time of day as the fallback. If you don't have the virtual timer, you have to do something. So the thing is, right now, the compile time option is, do you have it or don't you have it? If you have it, you're going to have to provide two alternatives. One if the hardware cap says it's there, and one if the hardware cap says it's not.
Alright, and why don't you try to write something like that, and maybe that's all tomorrow.
Okay.
And then we can get it right there.
Yeah. Okay. So I'd like to see less unhappy faces coming from you when you talk about each time, you're like, oh, there's no support for it. So you have to make a choice.
I don't know whether you can say as an update cap feature is fine.
Yeah,
I'll have to find out.
Alright.
If it were, would that solve
the problem? Yeah.
Yeah, it does. But
yes. So I think we have a couple of potential solutions depending on what the compiler and or kernel picture is.
Yeah, you have two solutions. Runtime or build time. Right. So you can do either one of those. Maintain release branches. I just want to briefly reiterate that we discussed as a community that the release manager and maintain release branch process needs to be lighter, faster, and thinner. So the discussed consensus was the release manager has the right to veto things going into a release branch, but that's it. And so the general consensus would be that the distro maintainers, when the release branch is made, if your patch goes into master, you can then say, hey, that's a reasonable patch, you go into one of the stable branches, would email libc alpha and say I'm backporting to 219 and 218 if I need it, and that way other people can see what backports are doing and just commit. If you got accepted commits on master,
So no way, I think basically we're going to say that essentially all distro UNG package maintainers have the same rule as architecture subsystem maintainers for doing release backports.
That's right.
Which means, post and see if anybody objects, and if we just hear crickets, then it's fine just to backport.
Yeah, the consensus being that if
stated rules for backports, which means it's only backports if things are already on master.
Yeah, it's always master first, and then if you're a distro maintainer, if you need it for 219, put it in.
And I assume that distributions are already doing this. I would say, we expect distro containers to not just, yes, it's a backport of something that is already on master, but also the backport you have built in your distro package and done some amount of testing of the backport.
So there could be, I suspect there might be like one or two exceptions to that rule sometimes.
No, I mean
the other way, where you might have a different patch for the master than the backport.
What we mean by being on master is that the user visible bug is fixed on master.
Okay. And the master should not regress from the
behavior. The behavior that is now the correct behavior has to be on master first before any backport. That's why the backport is not just applying to patches, it's because you may need to rework it for a backport. And there can be the normal consensus-based review for the details of any non-trivial difference in the backport from what the original patch was.
Yeah. The point being that
we want to make that folks who are distro maintainers know that, rather than carrying distro patches, you should say,
Yeah, that's right. And then other people interested in other release branches should put them in. And the release branches, I don't plan, and nobody else has planned to do point releases. They roll as stable branches. Things going into them have to be API stable. And the distros can then merge from those stable release branches. So that's it, just a reminder.
And if there's, you know, if there is any interest in having part releases, then we can do them, you know, on a spot basis if somebody is motivated. But
yeah,
probably we're not going to have any community point releases because there's no sign that anybody would want.
No, the distros do their point releases based on the maintained.
And distros seem all to want to do it without changing, you know, the name of the number that's in the filing.
Yeah. So the next point I was going to ask was, at Evercall, you're here. What is the pthread cancel status work that you're doing on? How does that look? Do you need any help? Are you stuck anywhere? Because from the community perspective, for those of you who aren't aware, the current implementation for pthread cancel is racing. The asynchronous enablement around syscalls causes serious problems for incoming signals and things like that. So, do you need any help?
Right now, I have it fixed for the attention that has access, which is the x86 part, which is the part of the C.
Yeah.
And R. So, I will probably need help for the remaining architecture that I don't have access, which is basically all the remaining ones. But,
yeah, it doesn't mean you should be doing all the work. Yeah.
But if you're, you know, if you're willing to take a crack at it, then
yeah,
try it.
My plan right now is to make the skeleton requires to, so I can pass along the type of containers. It basically create the infrastructure so that to build, to not broke the build, so that things will build, and then we require some work to finish the inline assembly required to finish this work. And the inline syscall call that needs to be written that affects the current stats that I have on the stats.
How can I help you? So, for example, I have access, to, you know, I can help with S390, 64-bit and 32-bit, or I can get IBM people to help up with those because I know you have a list of them in the list of things. PPC64LE, does that.
Yeah,
is that
currently supported? Right now, I probably need some reviews of the current stats I have posted.
Okay.
Then, after that, I can update my brain and I can start to work with the skeleton for the remaining architectures. And then I can contact each maintainer to give some feedback for what I need to be done. Basically, I need to fix this remaining architectures and just the APIs for each one.
Yeah. So, I guess my question is, can you take the action editor to repost your patches and ping me
sure.
for architecture
yeah.
that you don't have in the
paper? Yeah, I'm going to do this when the 2.3 opens.
Okay, it's open.
And
I open it.
Yeah. And that's my next task. I'm going to do on this issue. Repost all the patches I have posted and create the skeleton to the maintainers for each architecture.
Yeah. So the hard thing there is going to be the architectures for which the maintainers don't have a lot of time to contribute, so it's going to be, you know,
yeah.
Spark, Alpha.
Yeah, I mean, once the core architectures are sort of ready to go, I think this is something where we can just, you know,
as a community,
give a week of notice and say, this is going to go in, and other architectures will be broken unless you catch up or
yeah.
say something.
And,
some of that stuff before, and if not, I'll pull in the IBM guys to help out.
I believe that
doesn't matter. I think Roland's comment is like at the end of the month we'll put it in, and that'll give them 5 months to figure out how to catch up with the implementation, and they know the API the best, so they just have to do it, otherwise it's broken. Okay. Yeah.
So Carlos, in the interest of time, I think we should skip this next item and just say that anybody concerned with that should come to suggestions, benchmarking bottom.
Absolutely. Yeah. So if you are, I mean, yeah, you want to say something in trouble?
Yeah, quick follow-up question. Do you need any help regarding cancellation points? So if Futex API also has already has cancelable versions, but do you need any other help regarding? Okay, great.
Yeah. So, one of the last
friends with more kernel people, right? It requires.
As the fault is that.
It is. So you make friends with kernel people and we discuss, you know, those interfaces and how we get more of them. But you're right. We are underutilizing VDSO for things in glibc where we could be doing a better job. But I, as always, my usual comment is write up some document, some design document, where you straw man a number of things that you think might be useful VDSO. Because the kernel guy is going to say, well, what functions do you want implemented? Right?
Yeah.
Or what data do you want exported on the data page? Right? Because now we have the option to do functions and global data in that VDSO. And so if you were to write a design document, stick it on the wiki, and you basically keep hammering it away at those kernel guys, like, here's the design doc, these are the functions we want, please implement one of these. So.
Or even implement it yourself.
Sometimes
VDSO is not that hard to implement.
So on the subject of making friends with code developers, is there a GWC appearance in Columbus?
There has not been in several years. So
seems to be the ideal place.
So what was the question? What's the
what? Why is the new GWC presence in Columbus?
Is the invitation thing they have invited to?
No, you make a proposal.
Oh, all right. Well, yes. It doesn't have to be. So, turns out to be technically to be a glibc talk or a BOF, it doesn't have to be Carlos or me or us together. Somebody else could do it.
If there's anyone in this room that goes to plumbers, I am more than happy to help you write a collaborative talk. You and I can work together and we'll write a talk, and then, like, every one of you in this room is empowered to give a talk at Plumbers or any kernel summit that you go to present whatever the community is doing, get feedback, and run it back to the community. I don't do anything that is magic other than be Latin and talk louder than you, right? Like, do you go to Plumbers, Michael?
I know you should.
Done! And the fact that you understand many of the APIs better than the libc developers themselves because you come at it from a different slant makes you a perfect person to present and talk on behalf of the community. From my perspective, you are a community member.
It's a little bit you like to make proposals. Proposal with a close a while.
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean,
so I definitely we should say we, you know, we should have more involvement with whatever.
And this probably also applies to GCC. So I've been talking with Paul McKenney about atomics and compiler optimizations, where it's just a matter of the kernel's memory model, and there's a lot of misunderstanding about the direction it seems. And so.
Sounds like we're all just going to do this with C talk at Plumbers next
year. Yeah. Well, so the only response there is we need a robust set of people that come from various other communities within libc to keep hammering home our message of what are we doing for concurrency, what is the project goals overall, how are they progressing, where are we coordinating, what do you need help with. So, you know, any GCC developers in the room that also work on glibc, I expect you to take the message to the GCC community to talk about those things that you know about in glibc. And, like, don't be afraid to make statements and say, you know, like, this is what I know about the glibc community, this is what we're working on. So.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
When I get the interface, is there consensus about publishing PID or not?
The public's what?
PID.
That is an entirely orthogonal discussion. So publishing TID, TIDs as a first class citizen.
Like
there, I would say.
what is a TID documenting, what interfaces take TIDs, documenting if we even want to expose TIDs, documenting if pthread T can be
used. And that is related to something that has come up on them on the list and you did not discuss at all here, which is the Linux system call stub issue, which is along the same line. So those are things